It's a pleasure to have David Rohde with us this evening. You know, this book is a book that I think would be worthy of discussion any evening or any day, but I think we can all agree that it's a particularly apt subject, and he's a particularly appropriate author to have here tonight in the aftermath of the very tragic events in Boston last week. So thank you for giving us the opportunity to have a serious and thoughtful discussion about issues that I think are commanding everyone's increased attention in the past few days. It's an important book. David Rohde is the ideal person to lay out the sorts of questions that need to be asked, the challenges that we face, and also to offer some prescriptions for how the United States can arrive at a more effective approach to meeting both the challenges and the opportunities presented to us in the Islamic world. Now, those of you who know his history know that there are a few journalists who bring to his writing and to this sort of a subject the depth of experiences he personally has had in his many years as a foreign correspondent. Working for the Christian Science Monitor, he was the first journalist to go to Srebrenica and to expose the genocide in Bosnia. This coverage landed him in a Bosnian Serb jail for, I think, several weeks.
Only 10 days
was he in the Bosnian Serbian jail, so still sounds pretty long to me. He also, for that coverage, earned his first of two Pulitzer Prizes. He joined the New York Times after that, covered the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and I think most of you probably know that he was abducted in 2009 by the Taliban, held in captivity for 7 months before escaping. I was just joking to his brother that it was really a good move not to let him travel to any crazy places writing this book. So here he is, thankfully, without having had any more of those kinds of experiences. He's the author of two previous books. He's now a columnist for Reuters and The Atlantic, and he has most recently turned his attention to the significant amount of blood and treasure that the United States has expended on military, diplomatic, and development efforts in the Middle East and other hotspots since the beginning of the so-called War on Terror. David's book takes a close look at where our dollars have gone, why good intentions so often collide with misperceptions in both directions and on both sides, and with misguided strategies that ultimately don't provide us with the security and popular support around the world that we're hoping to achieve. He's worried about the erosion of our own civilian institutions as we attempt to help grow civil society in other places. He worries about the increasing reliance on privatization and the use of contractors, and he worries that opportunities for the United States to partner with more moderate and responsible state and non-state actors are being squandered. As I'm sure he'll tell you, he also has many ideas in mind about how to correct this situation. I hope you all join me in welcoming David Rohde to Politics and Prose.
Thank you so much. You should just keep speaking, because I think that, in a way, a better and more articulate summary than what I have to offer. Thank you, and thank you for this bookstore. And I appreciate everybody coming here tonight. And it's just so, this is such a great institution and such a great thing for this city and this country. And I am honored to be here. And I just really appreciate it. And I want to ask you first to be patient with me. This is actually only the second time I've talked about this book. It just came out last week. So this might be a little rough tonight, but hopefully we'll get through this well together. There are also many of my good friends here, so that makes me extra nervous. I do feel, I mean, it is awkward, with the terrible events that happened in Boston, and my heart goes out to all the victims up there. It was sort of a shocking thing. One of the people that's here tonight is my brother, Eric. We actually grew up or spent part of our youth outside of Boston in a town called Wellesley. Where is my brother? Did he leave? There he is. Eric, I went to junior high there. Eric went through high school in Wellesley and then later on became a police officer in Wellesley, Massachusetts. He had friends that were sent down into Boston to help out with the security down there. He now lives in Northern Virginia and helps manage a helicopter ambulance service. It's still a form of public service, but I thank him, and I think all the people in law enforcement did an absolutely incredible job up in Boston this last week, and I just appreciate them for everything they do. There are a couple other friends I want to recognize tonight for a different type of service, for their journalistic service. One is Missy Ryan, who's right here in front. She's a colleague from Reuters. For the last decade, she covered the conflicts in Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Libya. Incredible bravery she showed in all those countries, and an incredible journalism. Warren Strobel, who's an editor at Reuters, was one of the team that were the only people that got the weapons of mass destruction story right before the U.S. invasion in 2003. He was then working at McClatchy Newspapers with Jonathan Landay, and they kept warning everyone that there was no proof of WMD, and unfortunately, larger outlets didn't pick it up. And lastly is a friend of mine, Kathleen Reen, who's been working since she and I met in Bosnia 20 years ago, training local journalists around the world and doing an incredible job of creating local media that hold leaders accountable and hopefully counter some of the corruption and other issues that haunt these countries that I'm going to talk about in just a bit. In terms of the book, I first want to scale back your expectations. It's sort of a cheap maneuver, I know, but I'm not going to offer any magic solution tonight for ending terrorism in our country. I don't have any silver bullet that will suddenly stabilize the Middle East. My goal tonight and in writing this book was to sort of try to think about these challenges we face and think about this region in a different way. And I hope to provoke discussion. I'll, again, try to keep this short, and I'm sort of very eager to take your questions. This should be a conversation, and I want to hear what you think, criticize what I have to say, and I want you to sort of drive this thing. The general view of the Middle East is that as the center of chaos, particularly since the Arab Spring. You simply see news reports of, endless street battles in Egypt. Syria is just a bloodbath, and I agree, it's an area of tumult, and it's sad what's happened there. None of us know really what to make of the Arab Spring. Is this a positive thing or a negative thing? And I guess if there's one sort of simple message or sort of vision I want to give you tonight is the way I look at the region, and again, you can question me once we get to that part of the conversation, is that it is chaos, but I think there's a larger dynamic going on, and I think there's a historic struggle going on right now across the Middle East between sort of hardline Islamists, some of them are violent, as we know, and more moderate Muslims who I think are more secular, and they, and I am not, an expert in Islam by any stretch, but in conversations with these moderate forces and modern individuals, they talk about how they're very proud of being Muslims, and they want to be both Muslim, but they also want to be modern. And they don't see those two as in conflict at all. And I want to talk about that group tonight. And the focus of my book is, what was our track record on helping more moderate Muslims? And looking forward, is there more we can do in the Arab Spring to back those groups and back those people who they really don't want to be dictated to by American soldiers at gunpoint and sort of forced to carry out some American-style, democracy, but they also don't want to be ruled by jihadists who are forcing them at gunpoint to sort of live in this strange sort of 12th century caliphate. And this, again, might be somewhat simplistic, but I'm just going to sort of read a couple passages from the book or cite a couple examples that I think represent these two groups. I have a bias because of my experiences, the kidnapping that was mentioned. And one group, the negative group that I see on the side of this and a group that I'm biased against, would have been, my guards when I was kidnapped. During the 7 months I was in captivity, I got to know these guys fairly well. They rotated during the 7 months, but they all had, several things in common. This would be the sort of more conservative, more radical side in the Middle East that by no means represents the majority, but it's the one that you see and hear about on the news the most. So when I was in captivity, most of my guards were Afghan men. They were in their late 20s or early 30s. All had very limited educations from government or religious schools. Many had gone to madrasas. Some didn't make it past high school, and none of them had seen the world beyond Afghanistan and Pakistan. There was one guard in particular who I lived with for 6 weeks, and he was preparing to be a suicide bomber. And I had many conversations with him about why he was preparing for this mission. He was a young man in his 20s, sort of slim with brown hair and brown eyes. And he said he had studied engineering in high school. But years later, he was in the tribal areas of Pakistan, assigned to guard me and preparing for his suicide bombing. He was, frankly, better educated than many of the other guards. There were other guards that could barely read, but he had gone to high school and planned to go to college at one point. And I finally asked him after a few days with him, you know, why did he want to die? Why did he want to be a suicide bomber? And he answered to me that living in this world was a burden for any true Muslim, and that his real goal in life was to die and go to heaven. He said earthly relationships with his parents and his siblings didn't matter to him. And he, what was interesting is he was so well educated that we were able to speak in English, and he was sort of puzzled by me, and he was puzzled by the West, and he, like many of my other guards, was absolutely convinced that the 9/11 attacks were staged, and that there was a worldwide conspiracy by Christians and Hindus and Jews to obliterate Islam from the face of the earth. And they absolutely believed it. They absolutely watched these videos that kept showing evidence of this. And I think, and we can talk about it, I think this is potentially, we don't know what happened in Boston, but potentially this world that these young men were lured into. But they really felt sort of helpless, that there was this worldwide conspiracy. They had no way to stop it. And they were defending their faith and their culture and their way of life from this foreign assault. You know, and he asked me questions during the time we spent together. And one of his questions was he wanted to know if it was true that a necktie like the one I'm wearing tonight was a secret symbol of Christianity. He believed that, you know, as he saw Afghans on local TV stations, government officials dressed in Western clothes, that they were being forced to dress that way, and this was some sign that they were part of this Christian conspiracy. He'd also believed that we Westerners were very weak, and we only cared about the pleasures of this world. I said that I miss my family, and he seemed sort of amused by it. Again, he had been brainwashed systematically to not miss his family, that his relationship with his family did not matter. That's a clear kind of process, and it takes a long time to brainwash these kids into becoming suicide bombers. But a key thing was severing his ties to his family. And I was treated well throughout my captivity. And one of the most remarkable things about him was that I was brought newspapers to read by my guards. They treated me fairly well, and they brought me English language Pakistani newspapers. And this is, again, the sort of more moderate side of Pakistan. These newspapers would have ads on them for mobile phone companies in Pakistan, shampoo, and the ads would actually show pictures of Pakistani women with no scarves on their heads, and it would show their hair. And after I would read the papers and get rid of them, this suicide bomber in training would go burn them, because he felt that having these images sort of in the living area where we were was a sin, and that if he didn't act quickly enough to burn them and get them out of our house, he himself was going to go to hell. So that's the sort of level of, frankly, despair and fear that these young guys feel, that if they don't, you know, pray properly, if they aren't humble enough towards God, they're going to go through hell. And this is the thing they read all the time. And it was really dark and depressing. Another side of all this, and this is sort of the second half, well, it's not the second half of my book, but it's is another way of looking at all this. I want to talk about some of the characters that are in the book that represent a different side of a very diverse region. And again, I apologize because this is sort of all somewhat simplistic. I want to talk about a Pakistani American named Moniz Rahman. He's a graduate of the University of Wisconsin. He went out and worked in Silicon Valley for a few years, but decided he really wanted to, you know, test himself. So he went, got some seed capital from the owners of different Silicon Valley companies, and went back to Pakistan and started what became that country's version of Monster.com. And he also started Pakistan's first dating website. It's now the most popular website in Pakistan, and Moniz Rahman is sort of one of the most successful businessmen in Pakistan. Similar thing happened with another character in the book, Bulent Celebi, another a Turkish engineer who worked again in Silicon Valley for a few years. He went home back to Turkey, and he noticed something, that the Wi-Fi systems made in the United States, you know, made by Cisco, they didn't work very well in Turkey because the walls are very thick in Turkish homes. And he initially tried to attract American firms to sort of change the equipment, make it stronger so it would work with through the walls in Turkey. They wouldn't listen to him. So in 2004, he started a company called AirTies. And today, it's one of the largest tech companies in Turkey. He's expanded this system sort of across the Middle East, beating Cisco at its own game. And he's, again, an example of this sort of new, more forward-looking business class that's emerged in the region. The last person is a Tunisian. His name is Adel Tourjman. And I was shocked. I was in Tunis last year. That Tunis is a safe country. I want to, for the record, state that I did not go to a war zone. There was this brand new sort of sparkling tower there. And Adel Tourjman is the manager of a company called SunGard. I don't know if you've heard of them. They're an American software company. They've got about 17,000 employees worldwide. They specialize in doing back office things. They've got offices in India. And that tower I went into was a joint tower built by SunGard and Hewlett Packard. And in the SunGard side of that building are 500 Tunisians. When you call for help, I guess you get maybe operators in India and it frustrates you. What Adel Tourjman is doing in SunGard is Tunisians speak French, particularly well-educated ones. And what they're doing is back office work in Tunisia for French consumers. And they're doing very well. So if you're calling a helpline in France, you're very likely to get an operator in Tunisia who will then help you with whatever your concerns are for whatever company. They also write software there. And, you know, Adel Tourjman's dream is that Tunisia will sort of be like an India, an outsourcing hub in the Middle East. They're closer to France in terms of time zone, and he feels like they can compete with India in terms of that their wages are much lower. This is sort of the other side, and that sort of growing modern side of the Middle East that I think is representative of a different side of the region. To me, what's happening in the Middle East today, the biggest issue is that it's about jobs. As Bill Clinton said, it's the economy, stupid. The World Bank estimates that if 50 million new jobs, that's 50 million new jobs, are not created in the Middle East by 2020, already high unemployment levels across the region are going to explode. And I was surprised, but in doing my research for the book and even for this book tour, former Obama administrations were sort of honest about what a poor job the U.S. is doing on an economic front. Tom Nides, was a former Undersecretary of State for Hillary Clinton. He's now left the administration. He told me flat out the United States government has done a terrible job of focusing on economic issues in the Middle East. We need to be thinking bigger, or we're going to wake up here and ask, what happened? You have huge youth unemployment and no hope. And the frustration he expressed was very similar to what I heard from hundreds of Americans, Republicans and Democrats, civilians and soldiers in Afghanistan and Pakistan and Iraq over the years. People that go into these countries all agree that security is vital. It's the most important thing. You can't have economic growth if you don't have security. But they realize that in the long run, the best way to counter militancy was creating economic growth. But that consensus in the field, at least, never seemed to arrive in Washington. Altogether, we spent $1.2 trillion in Iraq and Afghanistan. And of that $1.2 trillion, 95% was spent on military efforts. And when we did make civilian efforts, there were sort of two dynamics that I thought doomed the U.S. effort. One was the sort of anemic state of our own civilian institutions, and the other one, frankly, was kleptocratic local governments. And I can talk more about that in later on, but it's clear that in some places we did not have good partners. And no matter what we did, no matter how well we carried out our programs, it just simply wasn't going to work. What struck me was that I found sort of hundreds of American civilians, engineers, teachers, people that volunteered to go over to Iraq and Afghanistan and Pakistan, who found themselves trapped in this very dysfunctional American aid system. They felt it was dominated by creating what was called metrics, numbers, sort of schools built, students enrolled, the number of politicians trained, that would impress members of Congress. And as was mentioned earlier, for-profit contractors really dominated the effort. And the rise of contractors is really a reflection of Congress's lack of desire in increasing the size of the State Department or USAID. It's much easier politically to obviously vote for a larger military, but not for a larger State Department. These same dynamics that I saw sort of continue. One person I met in researching the book was a Tunisian-American named Sami Ben Ramdani. He's a 48-year-old eBay executive, and he was asked in 2011 to be part of a State Department delegation to North Africa. This was an outgrowth of President Obama's 2009 speech in Cairo, which was very popular in the region and raised a lot of hopes there. And so what Ben Ramdani did was he went to Tunisia, Morocco, and Algeria with a group of high-tech executives and angel investors. And in each of these countries, they stopped, and the U.S. Embassy sponsored a competition where young people would come up with business ideas for high-tech startups. And there were dozens of people that would apply. The top 50 would actually get to come in and meet these Americans. And I wasn't there, but I was told it was this very exciting day when the delegations came in. All these people were pitching their ideas. And the winner in Tunisia was actually a young woman who proposed creating a biotech startup. And the only problem was that Ben Ramdani and the other members of the delegation realized as they were preparing and making this trip and then eventually choosing a winner was that this program was so poorly funded that there was no prize for the winning entrepreneur. So Ben Ramdani and the other members of his delegation cobbled together some kind of award for this young woman who'd won the competition in Tunisia and for the winners in Algeria and Morocco. And that reward was a 3-month fellowship at the Tech Town Incubator in Detroit, Michigan. And frankly put, you know, we've got to do better than that. I think better track records exist in the region. Many people cite Turkey. It has its flaws in terms of democracy, and Prime Minister Erdogan has done some outrageous things. But economically, I see the European Union accession process, which through many years caused Turkish leaders to reform their economy, as a positive model in terms of creating economic growth. Turkey is not a member of the EU today, but the Turks don't really care about it. Turkey has a faster growing economy than any European nation. They are sort of growing in influence across the region and proud of it. And in terms of other positive examples, and I'm sure we will get a spirited discussion on this, it's a sad statement, but the outgoing Palestinian Prime Minister Salam Fayyad was known and credited by many people in the region for focusing on creating viable Palestinian institutions, particularly the police and the security forces. And I just cite him as an example of the kind of leader that exists out there that we could potentially work with. Obviously, he's leaving office, so I guess that's not a great example. But, I can talk more. There's also, President Obama mentioned that there's now 100 high-tech firms on the West Bank. And I interviewed an Israeli venture capitalist who's investing in those high-tech firms. Cisco has invested in them, and it's an area of the economy that can and should grow. What do we do about this? What's the answer in terms of U.S. policy? I first of all think we have to scale back what we're trying to do. I mentioned corruption, and I'll specifically name, I think, Hamid Karzai's government has been a huge impediment to things we've tried to achieve. There will be a new president in Afghanistan in the next couple of years, and hopefully it won't be one of his brothers. But we don't, if we don't feel that we have a local partner, I think we should hold back in our aid efforts. And one thing that we can do is create more incentives like this European Union system that was used in Turkey. 2 years ago, Secretary Clinton used the term economic statecraft. Any of you heard that at all? See, this is journalists' fault. We don't write about these things. But she declared in 2011 in a speech in New York that economic statecraft was now at the heart of American foreign policy. And she defined economic statecraft as creating jobs at home and abroad. And in terms of the Middle East, she sort of called for this sophisticated new effort to integrate the region's economies. And she proposed the creation of an incentive fund for post-Arab Spring countries of $500 million. And just for comparison's sake, that's we give $3 billion a year in aid to Israel, so it was $500 million for all of the post-Arab Spring region. She proposed it to Congress last year, and it was essentially dead on arrival. Last week, John Kerry proposed basically the exact same thing, roughly a $500 million fund to try to, create incentives for these countries to enact reforms. If you enact the reforms, you then get basic, breaks in terms of aid itself, and then eventually, tariffs are reduced and other things that would hopefully help, again, economic incentives to get people to actually do this. I'm not suggesting that we hurl tens of billions of dollars at the Middle East. We tried that in Iraq and Afghanistan, and it worked terribly. Specific examples different people talked about. Tom Nides, this former State Department official I mentioned, he says that we should use money from Persian Gulf states to fund a regional bank that would focus on small and medium-sized businesses. Ryan Crocker, the former U.S. ambassador in Iraq, Pakistan, and Afghanistan, he says we need to listen more, that there are moderates in these countries. We sort of come in with an American agenda. We've got to get these projects finished. We've got to get, you know, good numbers that will impress members of Congress, and we don't listen to these moderates enough. And then last week, another State Department official, Jose Fernandez, he gave a speech, which I think the title's great. It was called Diplomacy in an Age of Austerity. And I think that's a reality we have to face. And he talked about trying to get American companies to sell in the Middle East. In 2011, Chinese companies sold $150 billion worth of goods across the Middle East. That's twice the amount American companies sold in the region. But one bright spot was actually the United Arab Emirates, which obviously where Dubai is located. Believe it or not, according to this State Department official, the United States currently exports more to the United Arab Emirates than it does to all of India. That's because there's a huge market for infrastructure and energy, and those are areas that we do very well in, and we could be, you know, more aggressive in those areas, sort of competing with Chinese firms and other firms. You know, I mentioned this entrepreneurship delegation earlier. I think that could be expanded. Any educational programs would help. And I feel that overall engagement with the region strengthens American security. It doesn't threaten us. When I asked sort of people in Tunisia and other countries what was the worst thing the U.S. could do in the region, and they said it was to launch another ground invasion, that that would undermine them as moderates and play into these conspiracy theories about what the U.S. is trying to do. And then I said, well, what should we do? What helps you most? And they said private investment. They did not want aid. They didn't want big debt programs. They said educational opportunity. If their young people can come study here, given what's happened in Boston, I know that's difficult. And they also said tourism and interaction, that they would love it if Americans would come to these countries. I'm not asking you to go to Egypt today. That would be an example of a country that I think has handled its transition poorly. I think Mohamed Morsi's done a poor job. But I think there are other places and other ways we can interact economically that can produce, you know, positive results. And in the wake of Boston, I think if we sort of engage in this fortress mentality, that's in a sense what the extremists want us to do. They want to make this a sort of war between religions. They want us to discriminate against Muslims in this country. And, you know, it's very difficult to do. It's a tragedy that's happened there. We have to be vigilant. We have to, you know, fund our law enforcement and intelligence efforts. Absolutely. But I think it's a mistake to overreact and play into their hands by becoming a fortress and allowing bigotry to dominate the way we respond to these things. I do believe, I guess in the end, to sum it up, that over time, I think prosperity and working with Muslim moderates, not American soldiers and drone strikes, are the best ways to eradicate militancy. And I thank you all very much for listening to me tonight. I'm eager to hear your questions, and I know this is all a very complicated topic and region of the world. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
I in no way disagree with your economic thrust, but I was just reading earlier today on the internet an article by a woman I've read before, an Egyptian woman fleeing from Islam, Noni Dawish. Mm-hmm. And she wrote a very, I thought, logical and critical attack on the idea of relying on moderates. So my question is, if you, and I hope this doesn't seem impolite, but if you know that in most Muslim-majority countries in the Middle East, it's a death penalty offense to commit blasphemy, very broadly defined, or apostasy, what do your moderates have to say about that? Do we just ignore that for an endless period of time, or is it a problem?
Well, I would say that the country that's most famous for that is Saudi Arabia. And I think that we've made a mistake over the years by aligning ourselves with Saudi Arabia. They have spread throughout the region sort of this very conservative Wahhabist interpretation of Islam. I don't know of anyone in Turkey who's been prosecuted or executed for blasphemy. Jordan. I don't know that happening. Tunisia.
Pakistan.
In Pakistan.
Yes, the minister that was attacking
was
the blasphemy law.
Yes, I agree. Mm-hmm. But what do we do? There are people like him, the governor, who was assassinated because he criticized the blasphemy law. His son was actually subsequently kidnapped by the Taliban and remains in captivity. Do we sort of abandon this effort? Do we reward his assassins? Because I'm trying to argue that there's two groups here. He was a brave man who was a moderate Muslim that was trying to, you know, lost his life in this struggle that's going on for the control of this faith. And so my question is, how can we help people like him? And there are many, you know, Benazir Bhutto. Yes, she was killed, but I would say she was the kind of person with the vision and the interpretation of Islam that we are, you know, should be working with. So I think if we give up on the religion, that's what they want us to do. They want us to see all of them as the sort of extreme right wing, if you will, of Islam. And I just don't think that's representative of, you know, a faith that covers 1 billion people all across the world. And so I just, you know, you can disagree with me, but that's my interpretation. And thank you, though.
I have a very simple question. With the ongoing shale gas revolution, probably you know what I'm talking about here.
Yes.
Do you think that what kind of impact is going to have on the Middle East? And basically, could it decrease the importance of the Middle East that would disappear from the headlines and we would stop worried about what's going on in Mauritania or Qatar or something like this?
I think that it's going to, the shale gas revolution, the fracking, the increase in energy supplies in the U.S., it's absolutely going to change American foreign policy. We will be less dependent on oil from the Middle East. My concern is that China today gets 70% of its energy supplies from the Middle East, India about the same, and Europe as well. And the global economy is so interlinked that even if the U.S. isn't dependent on Middle Eastern oil, I feel like instability in the region will hurt the Chinese economy and the European economy. So, you know, I think we should step back, do less, not engage in ground invasions, but I don't think we can sort of ignore the Middle East because turbulence there will impact, I think, the worldwide oil prices. And we've seen that with the European debt crisis, if there's economic problems in Europe, we have economic problems here.
Thank you.
Sure.
If you think about Iran, say, it's not the Middle East, but you have the same moderate, we hope, some moderate Muslims, and then you have the ruling elite, who are very radical Muslims. How can we support the moderates without tainting them in the eyes of their own people? It's a problem in Iran. It could be a problem in Egypt. It's certainly a problem in Pakistan that association with Americans is toxic. They lose all their credibility with their own people. And that was the reason that Obama was sort of caught in Iran. He didn't know how to support the moderates during the Green uprising. It wasn't a revolution because it didn't work after the election. Mm-hmm. How could we support them without damaging them in their own country?
I think that you're right, and we don't want to be sort of, you know, we do undermine them if we help them overtly. There was an American effort to try to get, there was this thing, Internet in a Suitcase. It was a U.S. State Department effort that was, you know, trying to get technology in the country that would allow information to get in. Even in Iran, they've had a hard time blocking the Internet. Not a great answer, but I go back to Ryan Crocker. We should ask these moderates what they want us to do. And they might not want us to sort of publicly say we back them because it hurts. But I would cite the Green Revolution as an example, again, of this epic struggle that's going on across the region. Those were real crowds. There were hundreds of thousands of Iranians that wanted change. And, you know, they exist. As I said in the beginning, I don't have answers to these complex questions. But I guess I'd credit the administration in Iran with sort of backing off. And because it is a problem, if you're seen as too pro-American, it's an issue. On just quickly on Pakistan, I believe that there are times when drone strikes should be used as a last resort to get militants, senior militants in very remote areas, but we need to minimize them, make them public. They should be handed over to the American military. There's a very clear process where, and you can laugh about American military processes, admit when we kill civilians, pay compensation when we kill civilians, explain who we're targeting and why, and make all this public.
Absolutely.
We are absolutely shooting ourselves in the foot with this you know, secret drone strike
right.
approach.
Thank you.
I think that'll work out a little bit. I guess I would take a little issue with the weapon of mass destruction. The bomber is actually the weapon of mass destruction. It wasn't bird flu that brought down the Pentagon or the World Trade Center or anthrax. The real issue was stability, and Boston proved that all it takes is two creatures to create havoc among hundreds of thousands of people. So one part of that stability involves proper security, and that involves all sorts of places in the world, especially the Middle East, since what takes down a lot of people is anarchy. The other part is corruption. You've really not said how to deal effectively with corruption on all levels. You've talked about the top, but not the bottom. And then the other little impetus that goes on are drugs. Plus, that becomes another additive factor with polygamy, lots of families,
and poverty. Do you have a
question?
Poverty. Can you just?
Yes, right.
Okay.
The question is, how do you bring order to disorder when you have a tremendous number of illiterate people and high-tech companies that come into an area that really are out of their league in dealing with illiteracy?
I think you allow local people to sort out these issues. And I think there are people in these countries that are trying to improve education, they're trying to improve the economies. And I think that you train journalists, as my friend Kathleen has, to expose corruption locally. Believe it or not, there are independent TV stations now and news stations in Afghanistan and Pakistan that attack the corruption. They're not perfect, but they, you know, Afghans are as outraged by the corruption and Pakistanis are as Americans are. And, you know, these societies, and I apologize, but this sort of stereotype of there are problems of illiteracy, but they're much more complicated than simply, you know, massive illiteracy and polygamy. There are forces in these societies that are just like here, where they want better government, you know, they want less corruption. And I think we kind of have to trust them to, you know, train them, give them the opportunity to try to solve these problems themselves. And I just don't see how walking away from the region improves any of the problems we've talked about.
How would you deal with these creatures in Guantanamo who are on the food strike?
I first think it's wrong to call them creatures. I mean, they're human beings. And whatever they've done, I think it's important that we should try these people. I think that there's a general sense, and people talk about there are cultural differences. I don't want to say everything's the same. But one of the strongest things you saw in the Arab Spring and one of the greatest sort of traditions in Islam is the idea of justice. And I think not trying them, holding them for now 12 years without trial actually hurts our cause. It makes sort of average people in the region think that we're hypocrites, that we say we support sort of the rule of law and democracy, yet we take these people and we hold them for 12 years without trial. And believe me, it doesn't intimidate these would-be bombers a place like Guantanamo. They have no expectation of sort of fair treatment from American officials. They're delusional. You know, I live with them for a while. So being tough on these guys, it's not going to have any impact, you know, whatsoever. And we just hurt ourselves by, you know, holding them there for so long without trial.
And I'll finish off quickly by saying, what do these people expect from the virgins in paradise?
Next question, please.
To be honest, they've been lied to. I feel sorry for them. They've been used by their own sort of religious leaders and deluded into doing these things.
Thank you. They say independent bookstores are a threatened species, so well done. So, I have a question. I actually with alarm and disgust that I read your column day before, that radicalism is what is needs to be blamed and not Islam. I come from India, Hyderabad, India, to be specific. India has faced it for 50 years independently and for millions of years before, starting with the 9th century. And my dear Americans, I tell you one thing. It's the state of Islam. We don't have problem with Muslims. I have a lot of Muslim friends in India, and Muslims in Pakistan are more than in India are more than in Pakistan, for the information. But the point is, when it comes to the Sharia law that most of the countries do, including Iran, Pakistan, and the rest, it becomes a political issue. It doesn't become a religious issue. So that's the difference. The difference is, it's political and it's not religious that you're talking about. So my question would be, so let's take an example and say, I would ask you this question. There is a country which has a large army, and the army, some of the army is bad, and it attacks the neighboring countries. And the neighboring countries, good enough like US and India are, would come to that country's king and say, sir, your army is attacking us, so what would you do? And if the king replies, oh, well, we are good, but that army, few of them are bad, so you deal with them, not us. Don't blame us, blame them.
So then you're talking about the Pakistani army.
Well, assume it, if you will. But I'm not saying anything.
You can say, I'll say it. I think you're talking about the Pakistani army.
It's
and
not
you're
Pakistani
saying the U.S. is sort of saying, India just deal, you know, they do bad things now and then, but India, you have to live with the Pakistani army.
Well, but...
go ahead.
So
I agree with you.
So would you say, okay, your country is good, but your army is bad, so it's all right, we'll die? Or you'd say, take care of them or we'll get them?
I think, without making any assumptions about where you're talking about or anything like that, I think that the U.S. has had a failed policy of giving too much aid and too much support to the Pakistani military. The Pakistani
Thanks for saying that.
The Pakistani military, many of their generals, many of them have fought and died fighting the Pakistani Taliban. I don't want to impugn Pakistani soldiers. But there are senior generals and members of the intelligence service, the ISI, who continue to believe they can use militants as tools to confront India. They use and support the Taliban to, they feel, maintain control of Afghanistan. And they see this whole American presence, an effort by India and the U.S. to create a pro-Indian regime in Afghanistan. And you've essentially got a proxy war in the idea of Pakistani generals between the Taliban, pro-Pakistan, and the Karzai government, which they see as pro-India.
Right.
They are wrong. We should be working to back civilians.
Right. I mean,
in
second
Pakistan,
question.
And you know, and I think that would the loss of power by the Pakistani army would help stabilize the whole region. Sorry, it's a lively evening. At least we can look at it that way.
Hi. Most of the questions here seem to ignore our history in the region, where for decades we supported dictatorships for their resources. We could go back to Saudi Arabia supporting Iraq, selling them weapons of mass destruction, which were used against Iran. And now we're saying, by the way, they used gas against their own people and against Iran, but we sold them that gas in the past. So our history with the region is pretty bad. Our decisions regarding the region are very bad. We supported the wrong people for the longest time. And I'm assuming that is one of the reasons there are conspiracies there, where people think, oh, for the last 30, 40 years, they've been doing harm to us. Why should we expect something good from West, specifically US or Europe? And European countries like France have their own history.
Yeah.
In the region also. So my question is, with that type of behavior, it's almost like a abusive parent coming back to the child and saying, oh, please forget about the past, let's do something good. I don't think that's gonna work. My argument would be, do you really think that we, after the years of abuse and neglect, can go back and tell them how to live their lives? It just doesn't make sense to my head.
I don't think we should go and sort of tell them how to live their lives. I guess I think we should admit that this you're absolutely right, this policy of backing the Saudi family because they gave us oil, this policy of backing the Pakistani army because they helped us fight the Soviets, and you know, and we allowed them to then spread Wahhabism has all backfired on us. And I think we should step back and not be so public. There was in Egypt in particular, we're hugely mistrusted because we forget as Americans that we have supported dictators there for 40 years. There was an opinion poll last year that showed more people, more people opposed the Egyptian government accepting aid from the United States than Egyptians who opposed the peace treaty with Israel. So that more Egyptians are against accepting American aid than Egyptians who don't want to have a peace treaty with Israel. I agree with you. There's sort of a catch-22, though, where the U.S. is still seen as this sort of all-powerful force in the region, that we're behind everything that's going on. And, you know, I agree with you. I just think my concern is that we'll just completely step away from the region and think it's not our problem. It's going to be fine on its own. Maybe carry out some drone strikes here and there, and I don't think that's an answer either. And I, you know, it's not a great answer, but again, Ryan Crocker and listening to these groups. There is, and polls show this, there's admiration for the American ideal of democracy and accountability. We don't implement it very well. And there's also admiration for American ways of doing business, and I'm sorry to be a tech utopian, but that when I meet young people, you know, they really are excited about that. Not every person in the Middle East obviously can go work for Google, but many of them say they want to do that. It's this, and I apologize if it's a cliche, but again, this kind of Muslim and modern thing. They want to be part of the world community. You know, globalization is happening. You know, the most popular soap opera across the Middle East is a Turkish soap opera right now. That's about, you know, the Sultan's harem in the 12th century, and it's I just want to say, and it's very racy, and clerics in Saudi Arabia have criticized it, but, you know, there's just, again, this desire to be part of the world, but be, you know, sort of proud of their own cultures and not to be sort of so backward. Again, something between American puppets and, you know, ruled by jihadists.
Our U.S. Army, our U.S. Army Reserve, our National Guard, they're overstretched, they're tired. And the United States Navy and Air Force are playing the role of the United States Army over there. And where are the Europeans? I want to see the European armies over there. I mean, I see the French stepping up to the plate in Mali. But where to create employment? The Europeans, the Greeks, the Germans, there's so many other countries. Where's their armies? Everything is going on in their front yard. And I don't want to send a soldier, a National Guard from Wyoming, who doesn't know diddly squat about Islam, over there. I mean, I'm just tired of all this intervention. I'm a conservative, and we're done. And let the Europeans step up.
I agree that we shouldn't have any more military interventions. We've tried that. We've spent $1 trillion, and that's, you know, sending in 100,000 American troops isn't going to stabilize a country. I think we see that, and that's why I'm sort of calling for more sort of civilian efforts. I met and spent time with all these military guys. I remember being in northern Iraq right after the invasion in 2003, and towns would fall, and, you know, these soldiers would show up, and the colonel would sort of say, okay, Corporal Jones, you know, you're going to get the schools running again. Okay, you know, Lieutenant Smith, you do garbage collection. You know, okay, you know, Captain Johnson, you fix the electricity. And all the soldiers were like, where are the civilians? You know, why, you know, and that we have this overly lopsided focus on military efforts. It's the only thing that we adequately resource in our government is the military. And let me say, the military is spectacular. They train their soldiers. They, you know, have great planning for what they're trying to do to get in and out of a country, and they execute well. And, you know, I'm not saying other government agencies can be as good as the military, but when we criticize government and say it's a mess and it can't do anything, we don't criticize our military, which in the end is a government institution. And anyway, I agree with you, though, about less interventions. The French did go into Mali, but generally speaking, we're better off working and training and funding local forces in these countries that want to fight militants. Most Malians supported the French intervention. The key now is training Malians, and it won't be easy. It'll take a long time to sort of, you know, push back against these jihadists who most of the population doesn't support. It's much more effective when local forces do it than if Americans come in and do it.
I just want to say we have time for one more question, and I also, before we finish up, neglected to say that you're all here on a somewhat of a historic night for the store. We are selling wine and beer for the first time, and you can purchase it over on the side. We have the wonderful Bronson there selling it. So please help yourself afterwards, and we'll take one more question. Thank you.
What is your opinion of how the Western countries should deal with the problem in Syria right now?
I think, you know, simply put, I think that the U.S. should allow, there has been a process where the U.S. has been blocking or asking Turkey to not allow certain weapons to go into Syria to the rebels, particularly anti-tank weapons and anti-aircraft weapons. I don't think any aircraft weapons should go in, but I think we should allow the rebels to be armed by Saudi Arabia and Qatar. And my analogy is it's like Bosnia. It's a stalemate. It's an ugly civil war. There was a UN, you know, arms embargo in Bosnia, and that essentially froze in place the military advantage of the Bosnian Serbs. We armed the Croatians and the Bosnians secretly, and that's what ended the war in Bosnia. It was gains on the ground by Croatian and Bosnian forces, not magical American airstrikes that ended that war. And I know it will lead to more bloodshed in the short term, but I think that arming the rebels will end the stalemate there.
But my understanding is that Qatar and Saudi Arabia are arming the rebels.
The rebels have claimed, and it's been lifted now, but the Americans were limiting the type of weapons that could go in. They did not want sophisticated weapons going in. There's a new American effort where we're trying to, I think, vet who's getting these more sophisticated weapons, but we really were limiting what kind of weapon was going in. And they've had lots of small arms and RPGs, but they needed more sophisticated stuff to deal with Syrian armor and those kind of things. And to me, it's you arm and arm fully or you don't arm, not sort of half and half. Thank you all very much. Again, I... I appreciate all the questions, and it's good to have this conversation. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.